Hi, welcome to sunny Hampshire and Wiltshire. We're back here in Andover today. It's been a really hectic week on Town TV. We've been all over the place. We've been at the World Travel Market up at Earls Court. That's hectic. But we've also been to the Harroway School, where they had this wonderful fashion bash in aid of charity, and it's set up by the Anton Rotary Club in aid of the Enham Trust. So we sent Sarah Jackson, our roving reporter, down there to report on it. What do you think about this reporter's coat? I'm not really too sure. Steve, I think he hates it, but it doesn't matter. Anyway, we're out and about all across Hampshire and Wiltshire, bringing you the best of what's going on, you know, the community spirit and all that jazz. So anyway, over now to the Harroway School. Lots of fashion.
I'm up at the Harroway Community School. Standing beside me is Denise Gabriel. Now, Denise is the head of appeals and public relations for the Enham Trust, Enham being the village, which we have visited before, I believe. I wasn't with Town TV when that happened. Tell us what's happening tonight, Denise.
Tonight is a fashion extravaganza which has been put on by the Anton Rotary Club, who have taken over for 1 year raising funds for the Enham Trust Cedar Park appeal.
So this fashion show has been organised by whom?
By Bob Humphreys, president of the Anton Rotary Club, in aid of the Enham Trust.
And it's something really quite different, as I was saying in the introduction, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Yes. Some satirical sketches for us?
Yes, it's a hilarious history through the ages, I believe, but you'd have to ask Bob Humphreys about it.
Rightio. So what's your input to the charity, Denise?
Well, I am at the moment trying to raise funds to rebuild our registered care home, Cedar Park, where we have 98 disabled residents presently living in little rooms 10 by 11. And if this appeal, when it is finished, we will hopefully have modest flats for each person, so they will be able to live an independent life whilst working at Enham.
So tonight is raising money towards that aim?
It is. So it's a very important night for us, and we're most grateful to the Rotary Club for helping us.
That's wonderful. Well, we look forward to the show. We're holding a raffle a little bit later as well,
yes,
aren't we? So may it all be a great success. We'll
Thank
see you,
you
later.
Very much.
Thank you, Denise.
Thank you.
Thank you.
with a little roar behind us there. What a brilliant show.
It's terrific, isn't it?
Halfway through the evening. You've had your dinner. I haven't eaten yet.
Oh, dear.
You're feeling nice and relaxed and ready for the second half?
I'm feeling very relaxed. The second half is even better than the first half. So we won a lot of stomping, clapping, cheering, singing.
The audience has really participated well so far, haven't they?
Terrific.
It's been a really good evening. Bob Humphries is the president of the Anton Rotary Club. So you're sort of responsible for organising all this marvellous...
Well, the whole club is. We're a group of about 27 people, 27 businessmen in the town. And there's been a lot of hard work going on this afternoon, and you can see the results. Terrific. Fantastic.
Fantastic.
Meeting.
So tell us about your involvement with the Enham Trust, Bob, for the
Enham
year.
The Enham Trust, as our major charity this year, we've decided to raise funds, two things really. First of all, for the Enham Trust, and their redevelopment of the Cedar Park building, which you know about.
Yes.
And secondly, some of the proceeds tonight are going to go to a project that we're doing in Egypt with the Cairo Cosmopolitan Rotary Club, and that's to build an eye hospital for children in Egypt that have a particular disease of the retina.
And explain why that you're helping the Egypt connection.
The reason for that is that 50 years ago, a group of Egyptian businessmen donated what in today's terms is the equivalent of £5 million to Enham. A lot of money. That was in appreciation of Montgomery winning the Battle of Alamein, removing the Axis threat from Egypt, and it was a group of Egyptian businessmen. So we're giving a little bit back to the people of Egypt for what they did for us 50 years ago.
And the village of Alamein, if for those of you who don't know, who haven't watched Town TV before, is a village which helps disabled people to integrate into the community, to work. They help them. They've got social facilities and everything, haven't they?
Well, it's a bit more than just a care centre. It provides care, it provides shelter and homes. Disabled people can work along able-bodied colleagues there. People meet their lifelong partners there, and that's where they settle. And so it really is a community within a community, and it really deserves our support.
A rather special place.
Very special.
Your year of presidency, or rather like that, you'll be raising hopefully a lot of money for Enham.
Well, I hope so. This evening, tonight, we're hopeful that we're going to raise near to £3,000 towards that fund. And we will be holding other events throughout the year as well.
Marvellous. Well, I hope you have a very successful year, Bob. Lovely to meet you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Enjoy the rest of your evening.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay.
Alan New Street in Andover to get an update on the crisis and support centre here, and with me today is Sharon. Sharon, how are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
Can you tell us something about the centre here?
Yeah, the centre operates a drop-in which is open 6 days a week, and anybody that needs to talk or needs some advice or information can come in and talk to one of our workers or volunteers.
It's not just for ladies, it's for anybody?
Not at all. We get as many men as we do women that come and use our drop-in.
Do you really?
Yes, indeed.
What about children? Can they drop by?
Well, not so often, but occasionally a child might come in and need to talk to someone, and we're there for them as much as we are for adults.
But you've got accommodation here as well, haven't you?
We have, yes. We've got a hostel for women and women with their children who need a bit of support, and that's something that is open to any women that might need it.
How many bedrooms have you got?
We've got 4 bedrooms here, so at any one time we can normally take up to 4 families.
Now, I know you're very proud of this new washing machine you got. How did you get that funded?
Right, yes. Well, it took a lot of hard work, but thanks to the generosity of the people and the organisations in the local area, and with special thanks going to the Roundtable and to Test Valley Borough Council, we've managed to get enough money together to have an industrial automatic washing machine, which definitely beats the twin tub that unfortunately our residents have to use at the moment.
So the support for the centre itself, how do you keep it going all year long?
Well, we try as hard as we can to apply for grants, and Test Valley Borough Council are very generous in helping us. And local public are very, very good in helping us to get things that we need.
Do you run events to get money in?
We
raffles do, and
we
things
do,
like
yes.
That?
Last week we organised a jumble sale. We had a gentleman did the Great North Run, and that was sponsored, and we got quite a bit from that. But the biggest problem really is to keep the running of the centre going.
And so you're looking for funds for that as well?
We are, yes. What we particularly need, rather than money to help us get specific items like the washing machine, what we really need is people that are willing to give us money year in, year out, just to keep the centre running so that we can continue to serve the community. We've actually got a shortfall of about £20,000 a year, and it would be great if there'd be some businesses out there that could help us go some way towards meeting the shortfall.
Well, there's a lot of very prosperous businesses in Andover, so pitch in. Now, some of you are employed to work here, but you need volunteers all the time, don't you?
That's right. At the moment, we've got 3 volunteers that help with running the centre. We're holding a training weekend on the weekend of the 23rd and 24th of this month, which we're starting to train up some new volunteers, but we really would be interested if there's anyone out there that would like to help us in running the centre.
Do they need training for that?
They do need training, and we provide all training, and no experience is necessary at all, just the willingness really to help us, to help the public.
How long does it take to train a volunteer?
Right, well, there's an intensive weekend to start off with, and then there's 6 evening sessions which focus on the kinds of issues that they'd need to be dealing with at the centre. And after that, training is on the job, really. We help newcomers as much as we can to get the grips of the job.
Do volunteers change a lot? I mean, do you have the same volunteers for a long time, or do you have to keep on, you're up constantly on the lookout for volunteers, aren't you?
We are, yeah. I mean, some volunteers have been with us as much as 10 years.
Really?
Other volunteers will come and go and on to better things, university and better job prospects, things like that. So at the moment, we really aren't in need of some new volunteers.
How long would you expect, how many hours a week would you expect a volunteer to help you?
Right, well, we do ask for some commitment in order really that they feel confident enough to work with us. What we really look is for 4 hours a week, which isn't really that much.
No. So there's somebody, one of you here 24 hours a day, aren't you? Because you have to stay here overnight as well.
That's right. It's staff only that are here throughout the day and the night. And it's really so that if there's an emergency that somebody in need can always reach us via Andover Police.
Do you find at Christmas that it gets busier here?
Yeah, it does sometimes get busier at Christmas. I think really the strains and stresses of Christmas can bring a lot of problems to the service.
What's the most common problem people have when they drop by here?
Well, it's quite hard to say because there's such a range of issues that people have. But maybe the most common thing that people need to talk about is problems with their relationships.
That is the most common one, I say.
I think so, yes. Either people that aren't getting on that maybe want to work harder on their relationship, or maybe even talk about splitting up. And we get a lot of women come in here that have suffered domestic violence, and we try to help them all we can.
But do you do counselling for both parties in this? Say the wife would come in to talk to you. Would you try and get the husband in as well so you could counsel both of them?
All right, that's a very good question. Obviously, if within a relationship two people are having problems, then it is good for them both to talk together. However, we do realise that we're not specialists in that area, and we would try and recommend that Relate can see couples and are well trained to do that. One thing we can do now that is quite new is that we can offer any individual, male or female, on any issue a short term of counselling sessions with a counsellor. So independently of drop-in hours, they can arrange to come in weekly and see a counsellor and help to work through any problems they may have.
It seems to be a great organisation, and it's a blessing to the town. But is this throughout the country? Do they have crisis centres throughout the country?
Well, throughout the country, there's lots of different organisations that are trying to do some of the things that we do. But I believe that we are fairly unique in that people can drop in and see us without an appointment, without any cost on any issue that they want to bring, whether it be an emotional issue or a practical issue. So in that, I believe we're a very unique organisation.
How long have you been here in New Street?
We're celebrating our 21st birthday this
21st?
Year.
21st? Good Lord.
So somehow we've managed to survive through thick and thin, and let's hope that we keep going for another 21 years.
Well done for that. In the town itself, I mean, you get people who are volunteering to do various things for you. Are the students helping or anything like that?
Yes, we've had a great input from students over the last year.
This is in Cricklade?
Yeah, the students of Cricklade College in the Look Forward, Look Further programme have helped us a lot. They've been organising charity events for us, raising money, and with the help of the Rotarians and Rotaract, they've organised a garden makeover for us.
A garden makeover?
Yes. Our garden.
Never heard of that one before.
No. Our garden used to be full of weeds, bits of metal sticking up, a really unsafe place for children to be. But now we've got a brand new garden, which is neat and tidy, and we've got bulbs planted for spring, and it's now a safe place for children to play.
It's probably not a good time of the year to have a look at the garden, but we're going to have a look at it anyway. But what else do you do here? You said something about pregnancy testing. Do you do that here, on the in-house here?
Yes, we offer an on-the-spot pregnancy test service. Any time when we're open, a woman can come in with a sample and we'll have a result for her in 10 minutes.
No, oh, that's excellent.
And we don't charge for that, although we do, of course, need donations to keep us going.
Do you ever have to charge anybody who comes in here at all?
Right, for the drop-in, anybody that wants to see us, we wouldn't make a charge for that at all. The only payment we do need, obviously, is for the residents that are staying with us. We need to get a contribution towards food.
Well, that doesn't cost too much, does it?
No.
Sharon, it was wonderful to talk to you today, and thanks very much for inviting us in. And can we come back and see you for an update soon?
That'd be great, yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Welcome to Cooper's Chemist, probably the best place to buy perfumes in Andover. Come and see our great range of perfumes and gift sets. We have lots of gift sets at fantastic prices, such as June, Dolce Vita, at only £25. We have the widest range of ladies and men's fragrance in Andover, many at discounted prices, and the latest such as Diesel, at only £10, through to Vanderbilt, reduced from £9 to £6, to an Opium reduced by a huge £7.
Come to the Star Inn at Way Hill for the best Italian foods in the Andover area. From pasta to pizzas, ribs to steak of the best quality British beef, succulent breasts of chicken to Mediterranean cooked plaice, all at a price you can afford. Bookings are now being taken for your pre-Christmas parties. We can seat up to 30 in Gigolo's restaurant for the best in Christmas fare at only £14 a head for four courses. So please book quickly as we're filling up fast. Telephone Andover 772356.
Have you ever wondered what drink to buy for Christmas? Well, we all do at Town TV, obviously. We're quite aficionados of all that sort of stuff. Good food, good living, eating out is in, all that stuff. But what we're going to do now is go down to Obbins in Andover. They're going to show us a selection. I think Sarah's got this one again.
Christmas is coming, they're plumping up the geese, and I'm standing next to Jeremy Gladwin, what a grand name, and he's going to tell me all about the local wines because, well, not the local wines, the New World wines, all sorts of wines, because for Christmas, well, other than eating, buying presents and going to church, you've got to do a bit of drinking, haven't you? So, Jeremy, what's on the shelves for this year?
Largely depends what you're looking for. A lot of New World stuff. A lot of Chilean wines become very popular this year. South Africa as well has also become very popular.
Why have they become popular?
Partly becoming more readily available. Mm-hmm. A lot of wine writers like them. Also, because we sell them.
So let's start with the traditional turkey Christmas dinner. What would you recommend for that?
I think like a Pinot Noir. Got a very good a Chilean Pinot Noir. Mm-hmm. It's, connoisseur. It's made by a Californian. In Chile.
The Pinot Noir grape is very popular, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
But it crops up in all sorts of wines.
Yeah, it's traditionally from Burgundy in France, but it's becoming increasingly popular around the world. Mm. It makes very good with light meats, can go with fowl, and things
is
like
it
that.
Is it a full-bodied wine? Is it acidic or velvety?
No, it's very light. This one especially is very light, very easy to drink.
Mm. Okay. So that's what you have for your turkey. What about vegetarians or people who like to eat fish on Christmas Day? What wine would you recommend for
I think some like a Sauvignon. Somewhere like from New Zealand. This one's very good. It's made in the Marlborough region, which is one of the most important regions in New Zealand for white wine. It's very fresh, gooseberries, citrus.
A little bit light, so all that heavy food is just washed down with a light glass of wine. I like the sound of that very much. I'm not saying I sort of drink vast amounts of wine, Jeremy, but I've sort of got a bit tired of those Chardonnays and Sauvignons that are very dry and very plain, and I quite like fruity and oaky wines. For someone who wants something a little bit different than your average wine, what would you suggest?
In the Chardonnay range, something like the Lindemans, it's got a little bit more to it than a lot of Chardonnays have. Mm. Quite buttery, nice touch of oak at the end of it, and it really goes well with quite a lot of things.
Buttery wines are lovely because they're very smooth as well, aren't they?
Yeah.
Any other suggestions on the oak front? I love oak wines.
Again, another Chardonnay, again Australian. It's the Wolf Blast. It's barrel fermented, which means it really takes quite a big whack of oak. Mm. And again, it's very rich.
They're great, aren't they? And they're very fine. They're a deeper yellow, aren't they? To sort of recognise
yes.
a
yeah,
much deeper
they've got a lot more
yellow.
Colour to them than
So okay, we've looked at some of the wines. What about other drinks, the whiskies and the Christmas type of
the whiskies, it's quite a good range. We've recently started doing a new selection of whiskies with different finishes.
Mm-hmm. What does that mean?
I'm
not a whiskey drinker.
It means for the first 12 years of their life, they spend their time in normal oak barrels. Mm-hmm. And for the remaining 3 years until they're released onto the market, they spend it in port barrels, sherry casks or Madeira casks, and they give them a little bit of different flavour for each one.
Oh, I see. So you've got whiskey with a hint of port and whiskey with a hint of sherry. Really?
Yes.
Do those flavours come through? Really?
They do, yes. It only tends to work with the lighter whiskies, which can take more of the flavour from the wood.
Does it make the price zoom up?
It does, unfortunately, make the price a little bit more expensive. Mm-hmm.
Well, we're just out of shot of Rupert the Bear's painting, aren't we? They're having the shop redecorated, and Rupert won't go on camera, but he's in his plaid shirt, and he's painting away, all blue. It's lovely. So while he's busy working, we're just going to carry on talking about the booze and moving on to one of my favourite sections, which is the port. It's one of the few things I drink apart from ordinary wine. What's your favourite and what's your best?
Favourite is probably something like the Graham's. Chills are probably the best we have at the moment.
Is that the best seller?
Probably not our best seller. Best seller is probably something like the Offaly, which is a late bottled vintage, which means it's aged in the barrel and then bottled, whereas the vintage ports are aged for a very short time in a barrel and then go into the bottle where they mature and become more flavoured.
What is it? I went through a period of trying lots of different ports, and after about 20 years they become a little bit like a vermouth. They turn brown and they're more like a sherry, aren't they?
Yeah, generally that's when they've generally gone a bit past their best, when the fruit...
I thought so too!
It's when the fruit starts to go and they just become brown. And
but then why are they more expensive and considered to be better at that age?
Generally, it's not just age. It's certain ports have only got a certain shelf life, really.
I see.
Even vintage ports.
So we're in agreement on that. Up to 20 years is about maximum.
It can vary. Some 1977 was probably the best, one of the best vintages, certainly since the war. And those will go on until way into the next century.
Will they? And for the ones with all the money, who are just going to crack those bottles open and drink the bubbly, what do you recommend this year?
Champagne. Generally, champagne's still the best. Largely depends what kind of champagne you like. For those of you who don't like your champagne too dry, the Paul Roger is very good champagne.
Have a look at this.
Even though it says extra dry, it actually, the extra dry means it's not as dry as the Brut, which is the normal champagne.
Mm-hmm.
So it's got a little bit more of the fruit.
Whoops. What's the secret behind the bubbles? Because I don't really drink champagne a lot. In actual fact, it doesn't do wonders for me. But the bubbles, the small bubbles are not the real champagnes and the big bubbles are the real?
Generally the other way around.
It's the other way around.
The finer the bubbles, the more superior the champagne or sparkling wine.
And other people, apart from the champagne regions now, are not allowed to call it champagne anymore.
That's right, no. They're actually no longer... It has to be produced within the Champagne region in France, yes, to be called Champagne.
And apparently the best buy for this Christmas is the Woodford Hill. It's a 1995 dry white wine from southeastern Australia. It's only £3.19 a bottle, so rush down to the Andover town and get a case load of this. Thanks, guys. See you later.
As we do periodically on the programme, we go and have a look at businesses around the area. I was in here about a month ago and this whole place has changed. This is Ben Boxall. Why has the whole place changed?
Well, we used to trade as the Salisbury Discount Computer Warehouse, Tony, and we specialised then in second-hand computers. But we opened in January and it soon became patently obvious to us that people weren't really interested in second-hand machines. They wanted top-of-the-range, hand-built Pentium computers, and that's what we specialise in.
Ben, I know nothing about computers, and they're always on at me in the office about getting a computer in to try and get myself together. If I came to you and I wanted a computer, could you teach me how to use it?
No trouble. Absolutely none at all. That's what we specialise in. We can take anybody at any literary skill and take them to wherever they require to go. Some people just want to know how to use the computer. Some people just want to play games. But whatever your needs is, I think we can sort you out.
So, if I got a computer to start with, so to learn on, can you update that particular computer, or do I have to get another one after that?
No, not at all. Generally, we need a look at them, but most computers, if they're IBM compatible, we can help you with.
So how's business been since you changed the name?
Well, it was very good before we changed the name. I mean, the Salisbury Discount Computer Warehouse was doing very, very well. But as our association with Spire Technology came in to full fruition, we decided to brand the shop and brand the PC, and it has been exceptional. We are very, very busy, which is a very nice thing to do.
Coming up to Christmas, you expect to be busy with it?
Ah, yes, we are, don't we? We expect to be very, very busy. We have people have made orders for delivery at Christmas already, and our order book is filling very nicely, and we have got to such a stage that we've introduced a cut-off date, which is Tuesday the 17th of December, for the last date we can guarantee Christmas delivery.
How many of you work here?
Well, there's six of us in total. There's myself, who I tend to do the buying and the running of the business. We have Bob, our retail manager. We have John, our on-site engineer. We have Viv, who is our accountant. We have a Saturday lad, and we have Mike, who is our network engineer.
So it's a nice small company that you can... Everybody can get on with it. They know the faces when they come in each time.
I feel that's very important. It's small. Everybody has a specialist trait. In other words, I'm very good at the buying and the running of the business. John's a good on-site engineer. And Mike is, my network engineer, is very good at that. We all have our different trades within a trade, if you know what I mean.
When did you first get into computers?
When I was about 9 years old.
Really? That early?
Yeah, my parents bought me a computer, which was rather a very simple one. It was called a PET, and it was very expensive at the time. It was about £3,000, but this was in the middle to late 70s, and I showed some aptitude to it, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
But I I could always be wrong, of course.
Yes, you seem to be doing very well at it now. What sort of price range have you got in here?
Well, we try and cater for most people. Anything from about £700 upwards. I mean, we do some systems which are many, many thousands of pounds, and we do some very simple ones that are under £1,000.
So they all sell?
Well, as I said, people have different requirements, so whatever somebody's requirement is, we will endeavour to help them.
Do you think over the next couple of months you might be able to give me a few lessons on this to find out how to use it?
I think it'll be fun.
Yeah?
I think you'll enjoy it as well.
Well, the problem is if you get into them, then you want more and more, don't you?
Addictive it is. Yeah. And when we get to subjects like the internet, we'll never get you off it.
What is the internet? Well, I've heard of it, but I'm not quite au fait with it.
The internet, commonly called the World Wide Web, is a network of many, many thousands of very large computers, commonly called mainframes, which are linked together. And universities, museums, companies, they all have these computers and are allowing people access to learn whatever they need. And it can be used for making friends, finding information, sending people your ideas even as a forum. It's got many uses.
I have heard, so I've read something in the papers that it could be used for the wrong reasons as well.
Well, there are various things that we all hear. It's very sad that people can't use such a tool productively. And that's really, I think our company would recommend people use it for educational uses predominantly. And fun.
Yeah, and they have companies on there, like advertising and things like that, don't they?
Well, there is that, but a lot of companies who sell your product, like the major manufacturers, they have what they call websites, where you can go and learn about new products, the product you have. If they've updated a piece of software, they'll put it on there for free for their customers who have already bought, so they can come and collect it.
Somebody said we're on the internet, Town TV. I don't even know what they mean. Does that mean it just comes up on a page or something?
Well, you can have many things, but if Town TV wanted a page, you could use it for advertising, learning, telling people about you, or even details of your programming. Or you can ask your customers to send you email to you, and you can direct it immediately.
The fax is as much as I can work at the moment, so but I'll be here for the next couple of months periodically, and hopefully, Ben, you'll be able to teach me how to do it.
Thanks a lot. Look forward to it.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.
At Eclipse, we have a free consultancy survey and design service for kitchens, including exclusive hand-painted units as well as bathrooms, showers and screens, with fine examples demonstrating style and flair at its very best, and in a wide choice of colours. So visit the Eclipse showroom for outstanding value for money at 4 the Wyndham Centre, just off Southampton Road, Salisbury, or phone us on 01722 320 444.
Just before Christmas every year, we come along and visit a bookshop. And surprise, surprise, we're in Hammicks again. And I've got Jim Douglas.
Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm very well. How are you?
I'm very well. I haven't seen you since last Christmas.
I think this is probably that length of time since we've had a chance to talk.
What's selling these days?
Right. Well, we've got a good range in for Christmas, needless to say. It's beginning to build up now. And probably the first one that most people expect to see at Christmas is the new John le Carré.
Yeah.
This is called The Tailor of Panama, and it's actually set in contemporary Panama, so it's a slight departure for him. Apparently it's very good. We've heard very good reports from some of our customers about it. Good suspense, typical le Carré writing. For those other gentlemen who prefer the slightly more racy stuff, perhaps. The new Wilbur Smith is out now.
Yes.
This is the second of his Egyptian series of books called The Seventh Scroll, and it has all the things that one expects of Wilbur Smith in it, except it's now ancient Africa as opposed to modern Africa.
Oh, is it?
Literally, as you can see from the title, it has a rather Egyptian thing on it. And his last one, River God, covered the start of the series.
Yes, I read that.
Yeah.
Yes.
He discovers a parchment, and apparently it's a true, an existent parchment that he's built these stories around. I knew Jackie Collins.
Oh, yes.
Once again, well-formatted writing. Her favourite character, Lucky, is back. I don't think there's anything anyone else can say about Jackie Collins. You know what you're getting inside the covers, and it's always a good Christmas buy, good Christmas
read. Certainly
not
a children's book.
Definitely not the children's book. We'll come on to those later, but this isn't it yet. Slightly more, as it were, classic female writing.
Maeve Binchy comes from Dublin the same as I do, and I've read all the stuff, and I love it because it's so close
great,
to home.
And it's great writing. Yeah. I mean, great storytelling. And this is her latest book. It's selling incredibly well. I mean, you know, as she always does.
Yeah.
A really good book for mums, grands, and, as you say, even the gentlemen in the family who like to read these sorts of stories.
She's a great storyteller.
Exactly. I think that's the main thing.
Yes.
I mean, you can guarantee that you get really involved in the story, and quite believable stories. Maybe we'll go on to some children's books, seeing we're on this table now.
Yeah.
And for the first time ever, a complete collection of Thomas the Tank Engine in one book. It's, if I can open it up, just to give you an idea of what it looks like, there's a map of where Thomas operates from. And as you can see, it takes the format off the books, the little tiny books that everyone's used to,
but
they've just built them all up onto the one page. Lovely little details of little trains across the top.
Well, I know I've got a nephew called Thomas, and he's definitely getting that for Christmas.
Well, that's it. I mean, it's a great buy for kids. This is perhaps another great idea, maybe a good stocking filler for children.
I thought it was coming into the wrong shop when I saw that. I thought it was a pizza place.
This follows Sam's lunchbox.
Oh, right.
And he's now got Sam's pizza. So when you open it up, there's Sam's pizza. Mm-hmm. And you can go through all the different layers. And in the layers, you'll find all sorts of, underneath the mushrooms, you'll find horrible little frogs.
Don't really.
So real good kid stuff.
Yeah.
Slime and gore, and they love it.
Jim Mulder and Skelly are almost the names like John, Paul and Ringo and all that business. They're almost as popular as the Beatles were.
They are. I mean, it's just such a huge industry now, this X-Files business. They've, as you can see from the display we've got here, I mean, they've developed everything, starting with an Anderson and Duchovny, I suppose, biography book is the best way to put it. I mean, they're just mega stars now.
Yeah,
no matter
huge.
Where you turn, she had her own series, I think, recently, and he just seems to be doing equally everything.
I think she was voted the sexiest woman in the world recently,
wasn't
she?
No, that doesn't surprise me, actually. Yeah. I think probably the X-Files mysterious sort of alien thing probably helps as well, seeing that she might be in touch with that sort of crowd. So there's that. There's an X-Files Confidential, which is an unofficial compendium, but it's all the facts and figures that anybody ever wants to know about the X-Files.
I'm in my favourite section now, the children's books. I love them, absolutely love them. What's happening this year, Jim?
Well, needless to say, there's always a huge burst of Christmas books comes around at Christmas, and maybe this is one of the first ones we should look at, which is Christmas Kipper's Snowy Day. Everyone loves playing in the snow. I mean, I think even as adults, we still like playing in the snow. And this one's certainly worth having. It's a typical Mike and Pen story, ending up with people, or the characters, ending up in a huge snowball. What we've always wanted to do, but as children, probably I never succeeded in doing it.
It never happens, really.
It never quite happens. But anyway, they get worried that it might all they might lose the snow, but the story ends up quite happily, as most good children's books do.
As long as it'll end up happily, I don't care.
Yeah, as you can see, they've got good Christmassy clothes on as well on the cover of there. The next one we've got is The Complete Adventures of Peter Rabbit.
Oh, wonderful.
Once again, classic.
Beatrix Potter.
Absolutely, classic children's stories. Always a great favourite. And really, I think everyone gets brought up on them, and we owe it to our children to bring them up on them as well.
Well, you feel obliged to do it.
Exactly, exactly. Great illustrations. They're very, very famous illustrations. And a great thing for maybe grandparents to buy for grandchildren. Great classic with kids is Winnie the Pooh.
Oh, now this is my favourite. And they love Winnie the Pooh, and I still like Winnie the Pooh.
Yes, and Winnie the Pooh, of course, has gone on to be a philosopher and God knows what else. We've got him in the philosophy section as well for adults. Wonderful book. This is, once again, is just reproductions of all of the individual books collected in one great big volume. Beautifully, beautiful, beautiful book.
There's illustrations in there as well.
Yes, it has all the classic illustrations with Pooh and Tigger and goodness knows all the well-known characters.
Now that one I wouldn't mind for a present. If anybody wants to buy it for me, I'll have it.
Yeah.
And right, what's the final one you got?
Probably the last one we should finish off with is A Good Christmas Story, which is The Christmas Star. And as you can see from the cover, it's quite shiny, and it does actually tell the Christmas Nativity story. But we have this lovely...
It's a Jesus story.
Exactly, yes. The lovely glitter going all the way through the book from the star. First of all, little stars.
Oh, that's beautiful.
And then it comes... The shepherds see the big star. It eventually takes you right through the, as you say, the Jesus story, right across into the stable.
Well, that's wonderful. Jim, thanks very much for showing us around the store.
My pleasure. Thank you for coming in.
You have a happy Christmas.
Yes, and I hope you do too. Thanks.
This is Michael King with a roundup of local news from the Andover Advertiser and the Salisbury Journal. There are fears that with falling demand for the drug ecstasy, partially due to the well-publicised deaths related to its use, a cocktail of far more dangerous drugs are making an appearance on the nightclub scene. Head of the Hampshire Drugs Intelligence Unit, Kevin Perry, commented that numerous sources indicate that experienced ecstasy users are fighting shy of taking the drugs. They're worried about the effects it might have on them. It's definitely going out of fashion. However, other drugs are now making an appearance on the nightclub scene across the country, which are as dangerous and often more dangerous than ecstasy. Heroin, amphetamines, temazepam and steroids are all becoming more popular with clubbers to fill the gap that ecstasy has left. He added that this is a very worrying trend. It's been estimated that ecstasy may have been regularly used by as many as 10,000 youngsters in Hampshire alone at its peak last year. Hampshire County Council's cash crisis has deepened with the rejection of a £5 million bid for local government reorganisation. Council bosses have been informed by the government that they can borrow only £2.1 million over the coming year, leaving the authority to find a further £3 million from a budget already expected to fall short by around £21 million. Southampton and Portsmouth City Councils, who also face multi-million pound bills to meet the cost of setting up unitary authorities, have been given permission to borrow £2.9 and £2.8 million respectively. It is estimated that the overall cost of changing Hampshire's local government structure will top more than £40 million, some four times more than the original estimate by the Local Government Commission. County Council leader Mike Hancock said the government has gone some way to help the authority spread the burden, but had not gone far enough. He also stressed that the £2.1 million is not additional cash, but is only permission to borrow the cash, which will have to be repaid. As the nights draw in and the temperature drops, there's good news for Andover's rough sleepers. The night shelter opens its doors this weekend. From 9 p.m. on the 16th of November, homeless men can enjoy a hot meal and bed down for the night at Andover Baptist Church. The night shelter is run by the Trinity Trust, and the coordinator, the Reverend John Bolton, says there is still a need for the night shelter in this town. He's received numerous telephone inquiries from people asking when it was to reopen. And last year, a total of over 500 people used the shelter over a five-month period, and about five men sleep there every night. Night shelter will run until March 1997. The owners of the listed Chantry Cottage are on their last warning to carry out emergency repairs, and failure to take action could mean the Test Valley Borough Council stepping in to do the work itself. The building, also known as Ford Cottage, is in a much dilapidated state, and the Planning and Transportation councillors say that they want a further report at the beginning of 1997 on the matter, and that if little is being done towards the upkeep of the cottage, then the council may issue a formal repairs notice, a scheme that could end with Test Valley compulsorily purchasing the building. Test Valley's Design and Conservation Manager, Michael Ricketts, says that he's optimistic that work will commence soon and that the cottage will be undercover by Christmas, adding that if he could not get clear confirmation that work has started, his department will issue the urgent work notice that would then give the owners 7 days to commence the work. Mr. Ricketts also explained that the work would help improve the look of the site, already dubbed an eyesore by the Deputy Mayor and a House of Horrors by other council members. Salisbury. The County of Wiltshire has been strangely unsuccessful in receiving grants from the five bodies which distribute national lottery money, according to statistics produced by Dorset County Council. Wiltshire is bottom of the table when it comes to the amount of grant money received per head of the population. In 1995, whilst Greater London attracted £35 per head, Wiltshire received a modest £2.23 per head. Parties interested in the management of Stonehenge during the summer solstice period met recently. Those present included representatives of the local council, the police, English Heritage, the National Trust, local landowners and the Druids. All agreed to work for a normalisation of a situation which might allow those with genuine concern for Stonehenge appropriate access. A schoolgirl was knocked down by a horse box lorry as she left a Remembrance Day service at St Mary's Church in Alderbury, near Salisbury, on Sunday morning. She was rushed to Salisbury District Hospitals with serious injuries. Officers are keen to speak to anyone who witnessed the incident or who was outside the church at the time. Salisbury Police can be contacted on 01 722 411 444. A 95-year-old lady suffered burns to her face, hands and stomach in a chip pan fire at her home in Cherry Orchard Lane, Salisbury. Neighbours managed to put out the blaze and administered emergency first aid before the elderly woman was rushed to hospital. And finally, police rescued an unnamed woman from a telephone kiosk in Devizes Road, Salisbury, from where she'd telephoned to say that she'd been handcuffed following a friendly prank. Officers took her to the police station and removed the handcuffs using a screwdriver. That concludes the local roundup of news from the Advertiser and the Salisbury Journal, brought to you by Michael King.
The choreographer, we have just watched, well, I have just watched the most amazing show, and it's only halfway through, 1.25 hours of pure professionalism and lots of laughs. It was really great, Sandy.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Thank you. We really enjoyed performing it here in Andover. It's been really
I think you've
fun.
Worked really, really hard. How long has it taken to get together for the show?
Well, the show has taken about 2 years to choreograph and get
really?
Together. 2 years of hard work. And we have to choreograph every week to make sure that the choreography stays correct and we're still on top of everything. So everybody finds time for 2 hours every week, and then of course the shows.
It does show.
And we change the clothes every now and again just to make it a bit different. But the choreography has to stay the same because there's so much of it, as you can see.
So where else are you going to take this show then? Because obviously 2 years rehearsing and you can't leave it at that, can you?
That's right. Well, we're hoping to do the Prince's Trust in January. and of course we're always looking for more work.
So so far we're at the end of the war, aren't we?
We're to the end of the war. Now we're going to go from 1950, which was the Audrey Hepburn look, the very elegant long dresses with the very tucked in waist. We're then going to the mid-50s where, can you remember, well you won't remember Sarah, and I can't remember, but I know from studying it that none of the bosoms seem to fit the dresses. They're always coming out to little points because nothing ever fit properly. And so we're going through that period, and then we come to the period where the hairdos were out here and the dresses match the hairdos. And then we go through to the swinging 60s and the hippie period,
and
which everybody remembers. We finished
1973.
So it's quite a... There's more clothes, more changes of clothes from 1950 to 1973 than there ever was in the first half of the show.
Really?
Because most fashion didn't change for 5 to 10 years. It stayed constantly the same. But by the 60s, that's why they call it the swinging 60s, we went from long dresses to mid-dresses to minis going right up to where it was really quite rude.
A little bit of saucy stuff.
Very much so.
Just tell us a little bit about your clothing collection. I just found out that Sandy owns everything that is in this show.
That's right.
And that's not even a third of your collection,
that's
is
right.
It?
Well, basically, I was asked to do a fashion show with the Beverly Sisters for about 6 years ago for a nostalgic evening at Butlins. Mm-hmm. And I then didn't know anything about clothes.
Only
I knew about.
Six
I didn't know
years
anything.
Ago,
yes.
Only.
And so I started studying it. I asked certain charity shops to give me a hand because they were included in the show. And I got so involved in it, literally so involved. Mm. It's really a bit obsessive now.
Yeah, I can tell.
And I'm always going to boot fairs, to charity shops, to clothes fairs. And I pick up all my collections in that way. And now, over 6 years, I've built up a wonderful collection, probably the better than the V&A in London.
It's a marvellous
collection.
In 6 years, you've achieved
it really
a lot,
is. And it's so fascinating. You can wear something in the 80s and you can wear it now and you wouldn't know whether it's 80s or 90s.
Except for the power shoulders.
Apart from the swirl and the puffball skirts. There are certain things, but they never stayed in long enough.
No.
And you could still wear it now and get away with it. Whereas in the 20s, 30s, 40s, you knew what era it was from what you were wearing.
They were very
and
defined
went,
looks, weren't they?
Completely.
Very. And beautiful clothes. Well, we look forward to the rest of the show. It's really nice to talk to you,
Thank
Sandy.
You,
looking forward to seeing your son, Trevor Lee, in the second half. Oh, what a fabulous evening. Just before the crowds leave, I'm going to sneak out early. We're fed, we're watered, we've enjoyed a really wonderful show, and we've raised loads of money for charity. What could be better? See you later.
Well, as you can see, Alan's not here this week because he's off busy. He's up in London some doing something. So I'm going to go straight into the competition, and we'll draw whoever won. It's for two tickets for Norman Wisdom at the City Hall in Salisbury, plus this book, and I'm going to meet Norman on Sunday and get him to sign it for you, whoever wins it. Plus, you got a meal for two at the George in Thruxton. Chrissy, can you help me out here? Come on, then.
Right, I've got to draw this ticket.
You've got to draw something out of there.
Yep. And it's Sue Price.
And it's an Andover number as well, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Sue Price.
Well done, Sue. I'll get that book signed for you on Sunday.
She's got a lovely prize, hasn't she? Two tickets for Norman Wisdom, Salisbury City Hall.
Terrific prize.
Plus a signed book when you get it signed.
Well, I'm looking forward to meeting Norman.
And a meal for two at the George at Thruxton. Yeah. I mean, what more could she want?
We were actually there yesterday and the food was really good, wasn't it?
Excellent. Jacket potatoes, I would swear by.
Do you? Right, what have we got this week? Ah, yes. Now, this is a bit special. One of my favourite characters, and probably adults and children and everybody else who loves these people, this particular character. Who is it?
Winnie the Pooh.
And this is it, which we featured in the programme earlier when we were doing the interview in Hammicks. And thanks to them for giving us this. It's a wonderful book. It's worth about £30, isn't it?
That's right.
Now, what else have we got?
Not only that, you've got a £30 voucher for the sweater shop in Salisbury.
And thanks to Malcolm for that.
That's right. So you've got two wonderful prizes. And all we need now is the question, don't we?
Well, what's the question?
What was Winnie the Pooh's favourite food?
Was it marmalade or was it honey? A or B? Do you know?
Oh, I do know.
Oh, well. Okay, that's it for this week. And thanks very much for watching. And we'll see you next week. Have a good week.
Day tomorrow with top temperatures of 8 degrees Celsius, 46 degrees Fahrenheit in light southwesterly winds. Saturday night we'll see rain spreading down from the north, and then it looks like Sunday, so it'll be cloudy and cold with rain at times. Top temperatures only getting up to around 7 Celsius, that's 45 degrees Fahrenheit, and with the light southwesterly winds becoming moderate northerly by the afternoon, I think the afternoon is going to feel particularly cold. The rest of the week looks like being rather mixed with some sunshine and showers by day, some of these perhaps heavy and wintry at times, giving a mix of hail, rain or sleet, and then there'll be some frost and patchy fog overnight, giving some difficult road conditions. It will be cold, with top temperatures by day only around 6 or 7 degrees Celsius, that's 43 degrees Fahrenheit.